Hi, this is Michael Altos. We are finishing up our discussion of antimicrobial drugs, and this is recording part three. Now we're going to talk about drugs that affect protein synthesis or have some action at the ribosome. The first is macrolides. This includes erythromycin, or everyone's favorite drug, azithromycin, commonly known as the Z-Pak. These drugs are bacteriostatic. They inhibit protein synthesis and bind to the ribosome. They're effective mostly against gram-positive bacteria, and azithromycin is also effective against some gram-negative bacteria. Adverse effects include GI upset, especially because they increase your GI motility. Patients may also have fever, rash, eosinophilia, or inhibition of their cytochrome P450 system, which would increase drug concentrations and prolong the effects of drugs like midazolam and alfentanil. Tetracyclines, most commonly doxycycline, are broad-spectrum antibiotics that are bacteriostatic by inhibiting protein synthesis through binding to the ribosome. They are effective against gram-positive and some gram-negative bacteria. They're used in the treatment of a wide variety of conditions ranging from acne to urinary tract infections, respiratory infections, or chlamydia. Sometimes they're used during D&C procedures. Adverse effects of doxycycline include GI upset, mostly due to local irritation of the gastric tissues, suppression of the normal flora, which leads to bacterial and fungal overgrowth. These are drugs that cross the placenta. They bind to calcium, which is located in bone and teeth, and can lead to deformation, inhibition of growth, and discoloration. So for that reason, we don't use these drugs in pregnant patients. Patients may also develop sensitivity to the sunlight and have skin discoloration. They can also develop dizziness, nausea, and vomiting. And these drugs can potentiate neuromuscular blockade. Clindamycin is bacteriostatic, again binding to the ribosome to inhibit protein synthesis. It's a common alternative to penicillin or cephalosporins. It has good gram-positive coverage, but also good coverage of anaerobes, and we see it used a lot in ENT, GI procedures, or GYN. The dose is 600 to 900 milligrams IV every 6 hours. Adverse effects include GI upset, rashes, Clostridium difficile. There is some histamine release with quick administration, so it should be given as a slow bolus. And these drugs can also cause or potentiate neuromuscular blockade. The aminoglycosides, like gentamicin, are usually bactericidal. They inhibit protein synthesis by binding to the ribosome. They're effective against aerobic, gram-negative, and some gram-positive bacteria. They're useful in abdominal infections, urinary tract infections, also for prophylaxis against endocarditis, and for treatment of Pseudomonas. We often see gentamicin being used together with a cell wall agent like nafcillin or vancomycin. Ototoxicity can occur, mostly at high doses. So the low dose of 80 milligrams is pretty safe, but at high doses of, let's say, 5 milligrams per kilogram IV, we can see ototoxicity or maybe some kidney injury. It should be given slowly in order to keep serum levels as low as possible. Also at high doses, we may see some neuromuscular blockade, and that would be treated with calcium gluconate or neostigmine. Hypersensitivity to these drugs is infrequent. Bactrim, which is a combination of trimethoprim and sulfamethoxazole, is a bacteriostatic drug which affects two subsequent steps in the conversion of para-aminobenzoic acid to tetrahydrofolic acid. This is the folic acid pathway, which is necessary for purine synthesis in order to make DNA. These drugs are effective against gram-positive and gram-negative bacteria. Adverse reactions include fever, rash, photosensitivity, and GI upset. There is some question of increased risk of birth defects, especially in the first trimester. And in rare instances, patients can develop Stevens-Johnson syndrome, which is like a severe defoliating burn. The fluoroquinolones include ciprofloxacin, gadifloxacin, moxifloxacin. These are bactericidal drugs which inhibit DNA gyrase. The gadifloxacin and moxifloxacin are mostly effective against gram-positive and anaerobic bacteria, whereas cipro is more effective against gram-negative and Pseudomonas. We use this quite a bit in urology cases. The package says it should be given over an hour. And side effects include nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, and also some long-term effects on tendinitis, perhaps tendon rupture, and arthropathy. Metronidazole, or Flagyl, is originally used as an anti-protozoal drug, so it's effective against parasites, but it also is effective as an antibacterial against anaerobic bacteria. It's bactericidal by disrupting electron transport. It's effective in treatment of bacterial vaginitis as well as trichomoniasis. It's also used in the treatment of C. diff, abdominal infections, and brain abscesses. Side effects include nausea, vomiting, and diarrhea. It also can have a disulfiram-like effect, which means when patients take alcohol while taking this drug, it may make them acutely ill. Some people suggest avoiding it in the first trimester of pregnancy, but the data is limited. That's it for our discussion of the rest of the antimicrobials. Please let me know if you have any questions, and we'll see you again next time.